Hello and welcome to this edition of HxGN Live TV. I'm Bill Fetter. In this program, we'll explore how Hexagon Metrology is helping manufacturing companies use three-dimensional data to make better decisions faster than ever before. Hexagon Metrology's comprehensive range of industrial measuring applications deliver quality control solutions for over 100 industries, touching nearly every kind of manufactured component. Hexagon Metrology's goal is to deliver solutions throughout the life cycle of the product, from design and development, to manufacturing and assembly, to service and repair. With more than 20 worldwide production facilities and 70 precision centers, wherever your business takes you, Hexagon Metrology is there. Hexagon Metrology, a global leader in measurement technology, solutions, and services. In today's program, we'll be talking about how services are just as important to metrology as products, how education is an essential part of the manufacturing economy, how metrology can be used to help improve lives, when to scan parts and when not to, plus a whole lot more. We'll be back in just a moment.
Hexagon Metrology is the worldwide leader in measurement systems.
We have a long-standing history of providing outstanding products. You know, of course, our customer service and support is best in class, so we're able to bring all of that expertise, all of the technical know-how, wrap it in a services bundle, and present it to our customers for both short and long-term needs.
We provide inspection services, we provide measurements for assembly, we also do provide reverse engineering, as well as staffing.
We do the service, training, applications, technical support.
Contract programming, inspection, we do turnkeys, systems work, and we also have full training facility with classrooms and lab rooms.
We provide project management of metrology projects also.
You know, we've done a lot of great things for our customers. Everything from taking over an entire metrology lab to just doing one-off parts and helping them through a crunch time.
Customers today just don't have the staff and the number of people employed that they once did with the expertise that's required.
We've made an incredible investment in building a team of trained people, and the reason we do it is just another way to separate ourselves from our competitors and to add value.
Welcome back. And now we're going to talk about services, specifically Hexagon Metrology Services. I'm here with Al Chiasson, General Manager of Hexagon Metrology Services, and Pat Bass, National Sales Manager for Hexagon Metrology Services, and Michael Scoggins from Sturm, Ruger & Company, one of our Hexagon Metrology Services customers. So let's start with you, Hal. Service versus services, what's the difference?
Well, Bill, you know, we've always done service. We've done service in the form of training and repair and calibration and technical support. We've done that for years so people would come back to us to buy more metrology products. But we started because one of our customers asked us to staff an actual quality lab, and we were afraid to do it. We were afraid to give up all of our application engineers, and so we politely said no, and they went in a different direction, and we kind of sat back and realized we missed an opportunity. And we missed an opportunity because we have all this equipment, we have all this software, we have all these talented people with knowledgeable brains, and we have a lot to offer. So we sat back, did the analysis, and decided that we really needed to launch a new business. And so what we've done is we've built up an inventory of rental equipment, people for staffing, consulting, training, and now we're able to offer all this in a services bundle to our customers if they have a critical product launch.
Okay, so is services a big part of Hexagon Metrology's business then?
You know, it's amazing the success, the demand. I mean, companies just are not able to go out and hire a bunch of new full-time people like they used to be able to. So this has really taken off, and it is a very big part of what we're doing today.
Excellent. Pat, what kind of companies use Hexagon Metrology services?
Some of the typical companies that we support on a daily basis is from the aerospace business. It's from the defense, automotive, firearms, oil and gas, semiconductor, just to name a few.
Okay. And what kind of projects have we done for customers?
Well, what's common is to go on site and provide programming for their stationary CMMs, do some reverse engineering work, tool making, tool inspection, inspection of parts. It's very common.
Okay. Well, Pat, you brought along one of your HMS customers here, Michael. And How do we first start doing services work? I'll start with you, Pat. How do we start doing services work for Sturm Ruger? How do we get together with them?
So I received a phone call from Michael, and he explained his challenges on site at Sturm Ruger. And his initial request was to bring some staff on to help fully integrate his current newly purchased CMMs that he was wanting to put on the factory floor. So that's basically how we started, and that followed on after we trained his personnel. Then we looked at his current processes and looked at ways to improve it, make more efficient, improve the quality.
Okay. And Michael, you agree with Pat? You agree with that assessment? Is that how it went down?
Well, there's no doubt about it. We needed a little hand-holding with our new technologies, and it was nice to be able to bring people in that were knowledgeable in those areas and melt into our existing infrastructure and where our organization works, and figure out how we could best utilize some of the equipment. Some of the equipment, we didn't know exactly what it was all capable of until we really brought knowledgeable people in to help us with it.
Okay, so it was part of that knowledge transfer, actually, that we helped.
Yes, and, you know, training and applications and experiences from other locations. Yeah, it was a good experience for us.
So part of what we were doing was helping your guys get up to speed and really get you to the point where you could take over some of those functions yourself?
Precisely.
Okay. And you're in Arizona, is that right?
That's correct.
Okay. And what do you do in that facility? What are your processes employing?
We're a manufacturing facility. We're okay. involved in making firearms in Prescott, Arizona. And we have what I consider state-of-the-art manufacturing processes. Everything from the latest inspection equipment to CNC controls, robotics, laser systems, modern manufacturing.
Okay. So are most of those components, are they forged? Are they machined? What different processes are
really
we helping you out with?
All processes. We own our own foundries, so we deal with castings. We have vendors that provide us with stampings, molded injected parts, machine parts from billet, heavy machining operations, heat treatment operations, really the full gamut of manufacturing.
Okay. So, Pat, you mentioned some aerospace projects that we've done for with Hexagon Metrology Services. What is aerospace? What advantages do we bring to the aerospace industry?
Well, we bring our years of expertise, our factory-trained personnel to go on site on a daily basis and help them to assemble tooling, that tooling that's used to assemble the aircraft parts, sub-assemblies and final assemblies. We bring people on site to improve their current quality with their manufacturing processes and identify opportunities to improve throughput and to help train and get their team online to be more proficient with their quality processes.
And I understand sometimes we're also there because they're trying to go through a really extensive critical period in production, like a new model launch or an actual launch perhaps of a spacecraft. I understand we do some work with some of those companies that are putting together actual space components.
Absolutely, yeah. We have a number of companies that we currently support and have supported in the past to do precisely that. They'll get a new product that needs to be proven to current engineering and CAD requirements, and we'll go in there and we'll dissect what needs to happen in their production line and with that new product launch to make sure that they have a constant, complete, on-time product flow.
Al, what in your years of doing the Hexagon Metrology Services business, what's been the most surprising thing that you found since we started doing this?
Oh, surprising in that a lot of our customers, you know, when they reach, when they hit a wall, they often don't know where to turn. What I mean by hitting a wall, I mean they hit a technical expertise wall.
Okay.
And, you know, they get on Google, they start searching, but they really don't, I guess they don't know that their OEM really has capable people ready to help.
And that's sort of the difference between service and services, isn't it?
It is, right. It is.
They're familiar with calling us for something else.
Sure, if they need their machine certified, of course they call us, right?
Right.
But.
How would you say, Michael, you got to know us? I mean, how did you get to that point where you figured that out, that we had something more than just the ability to repair a down machine?
Well, my organization, we work through partnerships and we try to identify value versus cost up front. So we kind of did our homework when we originally did our purchases. We kind of researched that and saw who and what was behind the equipment. You know, what came with the purchase of a piece of equipment. Mm-hmm. And really, people and what's behind the equipment, you know, drives a lot of our decisions.
That's great. And so the people's a big part of it, because, I mean, the Hexagon Metrology Services business is basically people.
Yes. People and equipment.
People and
right?
equipment,
people
course,
and equipment.
But generally, it's people with equipment, right?
Correct.
Yes, we've
Correct.
Seen lots of examples of our people with equipment in the field. We have lots of pictures of people out in the desert measuring heliostats and doing all kinds of interesting stuff out in the field. So, and that's another part of the business, isn't it? Isn't it? It's companies that maybe have a need for only a short period of time. Is that right, Pat?
Oh, that happens all the time. We'll see companies with an influx amount of work, and they'll reach out and ask for anywhere from 1 to 25 employees at some times, and they need them immediately. So we understand their needs, do an assessment, identify the appropriate people with a good skill match, and we get them placed in site and perform the function that they require.
Okay. Michael, just kind of to wrap us up, if you had to tell someone who was thinking about doing business with Hexagon Metrology Services, if you had to tell them something that kind of encapsulates what your experience has been, what would you say?
I would say Hexagon has been there whenever my organization or me personally needed them. And we tend to build partnerships, and we feel that we have a partner with Hexagon and the Hexagon Group. And that's, I think, all we can ask for in this day and age.
Yeah.
Can't get that with a machine.
That's true. Gotta have people. All right. Well, you can find out more about Hexagon Metrology Services at hexagonmetrologyservices.com. Now, I have a few other things that I want to ask, actually, just one. Michael, since you're from a gun company, can you help me out teeing up this next segment? How fast is a bullet from a gun?
Well, it varies depending on the bullet, but probably in the 800 to 1,000 mile per hour range.
So you probably wondered why I asked that. Hexagon Metrology Services actually is working on a project that's going to be helping a company who's building a car that's going to go as fast as the bullet out of a gun. Let's take a look. Well, the Bloodhound SSC project aims to blast off on a remote South African desert in 2014, and the mission objective is to go from 0 to 1,000 miles an hour in just 55 seconds. And it's also a Hexagon Metrology Services supported project. And with me now is Michael Mariani, Director of Strategic Business Development.
Hi.
And John Ziegert, who is a professor at the University of North Carolina, Charlotte.
Hello, Bill.
And what I really think is interesting about the Bloodhound project, actually, is it's not so much about a 1,000-mile-an-hour car. They have two stated mission objectives, and I'll read them here. The first one's kind of obvious, to confront and overcome the impossible using science, technology, engineering, and mathematics. And the second is to motivate the next generation to deal with global 21st century challenges. So it's not so much about the car, it's about the inspiration. It's about inspiring students in science, technology, engineering, and math to get excited about those disciplines, because they're gonna have some really huge challenges to deal with in the 21st century. And things like that we're talking about here at Hexagon Live, we're talking about challenges with infrastructure, with energy, with clean water, with agriculture. All of these things are going to require some tremendous engineering solutions. So it's an interesting way to inspire inspire those students. So that is kind of a segue into our next segment, which is talking a little bit about connecting existing Hexagon metrology technologies with education. So Michael, I know you've been involved in that, connecting those technologies with educational associations or institutions. So why don't you tell us a little bit about how that's been going?
Well, we've been working with a number of universities in the U.S. And what we try to do is we try to identify programs that are focused on particular production applications. And so we really want to make sure that there's a direct link between an industry partner, a university, and ourselves. And then we want to tap into that so that we can better understand what the needs are and really stimulate some practical programs at the universities, and we get some insight into what the customer needs are.
Okay, and one of those universities we've been working with for a long time is UNC-Charlotte, is that right?
Yes, without question. We were in early involvement with their affiliates program, which was pretty unique, but most recently we're working with them on an EPIC project, which is focused at really more large-scale manufacturing.
Okay, and EPIC is actually the name of the center, right? Is that right, John?
Yes, it stands for the Energy Production and Infrastructure Center.
Okay, and what's the objective there? What are the goals of the EPIC Center?
Not everybody realizes it, but Charlotte is really a hub for energy production at a lot of scales. It's home to Duke Energy, the largest utility in the country, numerous engineering and construction firms that are involved in building power plants and the grid, but also manufacturing companies that make the equipment that generates electricity. Siemens Energy has recently consolidated all their North American operations into the Charlotte region, operates 1.5 million square feet, I believe, of manufacturing space. GE Energy is just about 100 miles away in Greenville with a similar kind of space. The statistics, somewhere around 75% of all the electricity generated in the U.S. is generated on machinery that was built within 100 miles of Charlotte.
So it's a pretty good tie-in there.
Yes.
So what's the metrology tie-in then with EPIC? I understand you're involved with that.
So EPIC is a partnership between the state of North Carolina, the university, and about 15 companies who have jointly invested a bunch of money to create an education and research center to support the needs of the power of the electrical generation industry. Siemens Energy made a very substantial gift to the university, most of which is to start a laboratory for large-scale manufacturing. And of course, metrology is a part of all manufacturing operations, but particularly challenging when you make things the size they do.
And I understand you're going to be talking a little bit about that at the conference tomorrow, is that right?
That's correct, yes.
So can you give us a little bit of a flavor for what you're going to be covering in that session?
Well, in this particular segment of manufacturing that we're interested in, companies don't have the same opportunities that high-volume manufacturers do to fine-tune their processes to be able to repeat the same thing over and over. Instead, they have work pieces that are incredibly expensive. A generator shaft forging is well over $1 million before you touch it with the tool. And of course, material handling is an issue, and you don't have any opportunity to practice. And that really emphasizes the role of metrology built into the process.
Okay, and what kinds of metrology tools then are you using to investigate these enhancements?
Mostly we are looking at modern non-contact distributed systems. There is some application for large CMMs in this, but most of the metrology that needs to be done has to be directly integrated into the manufacturing process. And so we're looking at laser trackers, white light scanners, things of that sort.
And that's, Michael, where we've come in, right?
Right, exactly. Yeah. So we're trying to partner with UNCC together with Siemens and then understand what their challenges are in manufacturing and then get the right technology in place or applied to these particular applications. And because we have a lot to choose from, I think it's a pretty good fit for us.
Absolutely, yes. So the partnership with Hexagon has just been really a great complement to the ongoing partnership with Siemens. They have pledged a substantial sum of money to fund joint projects over the next 5 years. And having Hexagon as a partner gives us access to a whole suite of technologies that can be brought to bear on many of those projects.
Okay, excellent.
Yeah, we're just really excited about the opportunity to work with both UNCC and Siemens.
Okay. And I also understand, Michael, strategic business development. You're also doing business development with areas that we're talking directly to other companies. We're actually talking to other companies and working with them directly to try and improve their manufacturing processes.
Oh, yeah, without question. But to do it with the university, you get kind of a double impact, because not only do you work directly with the company, but you're also creating engineering talent that can either get into that customer's workforce or we can take advantage of as well. So you kind of get that dual effect.
Okay, excellent. Michael, I'd like to shift gears a little bit and talk about computed tomography.
Okay.
Which is a technology that we've been looking at.
We've been exploring that and
looking for ways that we can incorporate it into companies' production methodologies.
Well, the CT technology is just a different way to acquire data sets. And so in some of the applications, often we need to have an external surface to contact it and measure it, and you can see that with even the large scale. But oftentimes there's internal characteristics to a particular component that you can't contact. And so the CT allows us to get that information about the part. Then we can get a virtual representation of those components, and we can actually measure the internal features. So that's a benefit. Sometimes it could be a very, very small component, like a stent that we talked about earlier today, where it's very difficult to acquire the information you want using traditional methods. So the CT allows us to do that too.
So that's great. And I also understand that CT gives you the opportunity to be more, get more of a real data set instead of just simply looking at something and trying to see whether it's good or bad.
Right,
it's giving you more qualitative results.
Exactly. And
a lot of people
are forced to use, say, microscopes or what have you to measure these devices. And they're doing it subjectively, and so they have to rely on the person's interpretation of it.
Right. And in large-scale metrology, isn't it somewhat the same way? We're trying to replace some qualitative measures with more quantitative measures by acquiring these point clouds and data sets?
I think that, sure, there's a lot of that. In many cases, what you're looking at is replacing measurement technologies that literally are 50 or 100 years old. Manual micrometers, things like that, and those inherently can't give you very much information about the geometry of the part. I think there's this nice synergy when companies start implementing these newer technologies. They get so much more information than they had before. At first, maybe they're a little overwhelmed, but after a while, they see the opportunity to understand their processes better than they ever have and improve them.
But the measurement technologies are kind of catching up too, because these large scale manufacturers didn't have that luxury to get that kind of data, I think maybe say 5 or 6 years ago.
Absolutely.
And now these technologies are coming to the fore and you can actually start to apply them, and I think that's what's really kind of exciting.
Mm-hmm.
Excellent. Well, thank you both for being on the show. I appreciate
okay.
you
All
being
right.
here.
Thanks, Bill.
Thank you
it
very
was
much.
It my pleasure.
All right.
Thank you, Bill.
And now we're going to go and look at something that happened earlier today. We're going to look at a double amputee who jumped out of a plane.
75 knots.
Okay, you got it.
Good luck, buddy. Thank you.
MG Grand.
About a year ago, one of Hexagon Metrology's large aerospace customers in Texas was going through a merger. To help alleviate some of the anxiety, they brought in Dana Bowman, a motivational speaker who also happens to be a double amputee, to talk about dealing with change and overcoming adversity. During his visit, Dana mentioned that his leg covers weren't really suited for his active lifestyle, which included multiple jumps out of planes every week. Using reverse engineering in the Romer arm, the data was used to custom make new leg covers for Dana out of aircraft-grade aluminum. But not everyone is able to afford prosthetic legs, which can run up to $30,000. D-Rev, a nonprofit product design firm in San Francisco, has made it their mission to develop products that serve the developing world for people who live on less than $4 a day. The ReMotion artificial knee is designed to serve the needs for amputees in the developing world who can't afford traditional prosthetics. There have been three different design iterations of the ReMotion knee thus far. The version 3 ReMotion knee is designed for high-volume injection molding instead of low-volume plastic machining. By doing this, they keep costs low and control quality. These are key steps on the road to global accessibility. Hexagon Metrology assisted the D-Rev team with the version 3 design using a Romer arm to measure the part tolerances that are important to the assembly, such as the hole size, distance between the mating surfaces, and the planes that would confine a washer. The team at D-Rev is currently in Indonesia to deploy the first 50 pre-production version 3 ReMotion knees in the field. The patients will be part of a clinical study where they'll compare data collected from the first visit with the data collected from a follow-up visit several months later. The feedback will help to be incorporated into the version 3 ReMotion knee before they come to market in 2014. Here's a short video explaining the ReMotion knee project.
The project really started with an impossible sounding challenge, and this was to design a very low-cost prosthetic knee joint for the developing world. We were told that the cost had to be well under the typical cost of a US knee joint. The goal of understanding someone's need in such a unique environment is to really immerse yourself.
There was only so much that we could learn in talking to amputees over here, and it was night and day when we went over to India.
If we ever had an epiphany, it was probably just getting off the plane. The amputees have a very strong social stigma in India, and that makes it very important in our design process to really immerse yourself in what it means to be an amputee, what it means to be an amputee in India, what it means to be a poor amputee. All of these things really require you to be there firsthand. One major turning point for me was when I actually wore this prosthetic. Through a few changes, we were able to actually feel what it means to come up against like a flight of stairs. It's one thing to see it as a design requirement on paper, but it's another thing to feel like you're gonna fall, you know, as a result of these mechanical elements. So I think, you know, they're all interconnected, the emotions and the mechanical elements.
And the single axis joint, if you ever have it bend when you're not intending to and you put weight on it, it's going to buckle and you're going to fall down. But with the four bar linkage, what you get is this nice little range of stability where if it's open a little bit and you put weight on it, it comes back to center. Helps prevent a lot of falls that would have occurred.
The first patient that was fitted was a young boy. His name was Kamal. He was a 16-year-old at the time. You know, you can see he's like getting around on this bamboo staff that he put together himself. What does it feel like to see the first patient? First of all, it was a prototype. We had to like file the edges down. And the partner actually said, hey, why don't we try and fit Kamal today with this knee joint? So we took a gamble and said, well, he's a young guy, let's just try it. where you really connect is somewhere after the fact, where you've seen Kamal walk around on this knee joint, and then you sort of connect with your mind, well, he couldn't have done that before without this prosthetic. And I think that's when I really just felt proud that we had done something good and this was worthwhile repeating again and again.
And we're back. I'm here now with Ken Woodbine, who's president of our PC-DMIS Software Development Division.
Hi, Bill.
And Bill Wilcox, who is vice president of strategic development for software with Hexagon Metrology Corporate.
Hello.
And we're going to be talking a little bit about software in this next segment. But first, I wanted to say that in the last segment, we saw sort of an example of what I call agile product design, successive versions of a product being delivered in stages over time. Mm-hmm. But agile is actually a term that's most associated with software, isn't it?
In fact, it is. Agile was introduced in 2001, and it's now successfully integrated into the software development industry.
And Agile is actually a platform that you're using today to develop PC-DMIS, is that right?
Yeah, it sure is. And I'd like to contrast it with an earlier development model, which would be waterfall. And the difference is, with waterfall development, you've got very little adaptation for change. So in other words, you would have a very detailed specification and you could build to that for months or even years. That could go on indefinitely. And at the end, oftentimes what would happen is we'd have a disconnect between what the consumer expected and what was actually being delivered.
Okay.
Now with Agile, we bring in an iterative process which embraces change.
Okay.
It recognizes that change is part of the process. Change is happening all the time. Change could be relative to the requirements. It could be a new requirement that comes forward. And so with Agile and short development sprints, which start and complete an amount of work, say in a 3-week period, that's demonstrable to the customer, you get regular feedback that's going to let you know if you're on track to meet his objectives as they evolve and as they change.
Okay. And how's that process then been working as far as PC-DMIS development is concerned?
Quite well, in fact. With Agile, one thing I've noticed, and I sit in on these sprint reviews regularly, is the developers are very engaged with the process. They feel fulfilled in being able to deliver something on a regular basis that the customer actually can provide feedback for, and it works.
Right. What is the first product that has been fully realized using the Agile development process?
We're developing a product called PC-DMIS Touch, and this was from start to finish using Agile. And the result is you can see the result in the product.
And we've actually introduced that today here at HxGN Live, is that right?
We sure have.
Yeah, well, actually we have a video of that. Let's take a look and see what it looks like. PC-DMIS Touch, that's pretty exciting. And we've got actually that touch on a Romer arm and a 454SF here in the zone. Mm-hmm. So we are showing it on both stationary and portable product technologies. But that looks a heck of a lot different from any version of PC-DMIS I've ever seen.
Well, it sure does, and it's a direct result of the Agile development process where with the feedback, we've been able to build it to the customer requirements. And in this case, the customer requirements are all about ease of use and functionality. Make it as easy as possible for him in an intuitive user environment to achieve his objective.
And what were some of the ways that we did that? What were some of the design criteria?
Well, first of all, the color, the use of sound, the touch platform made it quite accessible even to somebody who's never seen a CMM before.
Okay, and I saw it earlier, it's actually got contextual help as well.
It does indeed. I mean, it's only a touch away.
Yeah, that's excellent. So who's the target user for Touch?
This would be anybody who's got shop floor activities that require measurement, but they can't invest in very sophisticated software because they don't need it.
Okay.
You know, so they can do their job, but keep it simple.
Okay, but it's also compatible with regular PC-DMIS, right?
It sure is, and you could run more sophisticated, higher-end programs that have been developed by perhaps an engineer
So you're not limited to, you're not excluding what you may build with the higher level packages. You're just offering a user experience that's designed to allow the entry level user to achieve the same thing.
Great. Well, we'll be looking for exciting things to come with PC-DMIS mm-hmm. Touch. But let's shift gears just a little bit and look at more of the enterprise user at this point. And as we said, we have Bill Wilcox here as well. And Bill, you've been working on a product that's also being shown here at the conference called MMS.
Right.
So what's MMS stand for?
Metrology Management System.
Okay. And what does that mean exactly?
Well, Metrology Management System is designed to integrate all of the processes and the steps of metrology from the original inspection planning, very early point in the design process, to the collection of the data, to the management of the metrology devices, to the reporting of the data, the analysis, virtual assembly, all of these functions that are all currently separate pieces that we and products that we sell. MMS really integrates them all together and ties them together, and the sum of the parts is in this case, greater. We end up with more because they're all integrated.
And I understand that MMS came out of some synergy work that we were doing with other divisions of Hexagon. Is that
yeah,
right?
Yeah, MMS is a joint product development effort between Intergraph and Hexagon Metrology. In fact, at the core foundation of MMS, we're using Smart Plant Foundation, which is a very nice tool that they have developed, which allows us to manage large amounts of data and do all of the sort of relationships between those different pieces of data, and that's very helpful to metrology.
Okay. But I know there are enterprise customers out there that are already using PLM as a management system, so how does MMS and PLM go together?
Well, MMS is really a great companion to a PLM. Really what we're doing is we're taking the PLM and we're extending it into the metrology world, because currently many of our customers that use PLM, which is many, many customers use a PLM, they have very nicely integrated design and manufacturing processes into their PLM, but almost never have they integrated the metrology, the data collection, the data, the planning, the analysis. All of this is separate, and so with MMS we can now connect this product to a PLM, say Inovia or TeamCenter, a commercial PLM product, and we can then tie all of this information together. An example is from a CAD model that's stored in the customer's PLM, let's say it's in TeamCenter, you can actually connect from that surface that you're interested in, that hole, you can find out where it was measured, what device measured it, how many times, what the actual results are. And if the size of that hole changes, let's say they want to make it from 10 millimeters to 15 millimeters, we can go through all of that information and determine where potential impacts might be. So that's really the key of this integrated information.
Okay, and all that integrated information, how is that integrated into the PC-DMIS product, Ken?
Well, PC-DMIS will export data into the MMS environment.
Okay.
And then any other measurement device that's using PC-DMIS will do the same. Data server manages that movement of data into the common database, and the PLM aspect of this allows you to generate reports and actionable information from it.
Another thing, PC-DMIS will also bring in the inspection plan from the MMS and generate a part program.
Okay. So it's bidirectional.
Yes.
Yeah. So what kind of companies would get the most benefit out of implementing MMS?
Well, that's an easy answer. All of them.
Right.
Every company has data that they need to integrate and manage, and in every case, you will see a benefit by implementing MMS. And we've tried to package it so that it has different levels or different price points, because some customers have smaller amounts of data and some have huge amounts of data. And so we're trying to make sure that we have a scalable product that meets from the needs of the smallest customer all the way up to a huge enterprise global manufacturer.
Okay, great. Well, thank you very much for that overview, PC-DMIS Touch, and also the new MMS system. Thank you both.
Thank you very much.
Now we turn to 3D scanning, and we have a little video about that. Let's take a look.
Hi, I'm the Romer Absolute Arm by Hexagon Metrology. I have a 3D laser scanner, and it's my job to make industrial measurement methods simpler and more economical. This enables me to help people like Peter. The Romer Absolute Arm does not need to be warmed up or calibrated. It is ready to go immediately. Peter guides the laser over the surface of the component by hand, collecting high-density 3D data as he goes. As he does so, the scanner automatically adapts to the surface and effortlessly scans even reflective metals or black surfaces. And Peter can even determine the level of detail of the scan himself. By changing just one setting, he can decide to collect more or less data from the part, depending on its size or complexity. More 3D information is better for complex parts, right? The software now compares the original CAD model, a digital 3D model, with Peter's measurement data of the component. Thanks to the simple graphic representation, any deviations between the model and the real component can be detected at a glance. Peter can therefore now spot manufacturing defects immediately. The Romer Absolute Arm is very easy to operate and can be used anywhere. The measurement process is now not only far quicker, it is also distinctly more precise than it was before. Now you can see why not just Peter, but countless technicians from a wide variety of industries like to work with me so much. Whether it be the automotive, energy, or sports equipment industries, to name just a few. That's how the Romer Absolute Arm is used in Peter's industry. How can it be used in yours?
Welcome back. And this segment of the show, we're calling To Scan or Not to Scan. And I have with me a panel of applications experts, Brian Godowskis, Jonathan Dove, and Dan Genlos. And we're going to talk about point-to-point inspection versus analog scanning and laser scanning. So let's start with that video that we just saw. We saw some kind of a blade laying on a table, scan with a Romer arm. Should we be scanning that part?
Well, it kind of depends a bit on the tolerances that you're looking for and actually the actual part or the application that you're looking. Sometimes on blades, they want to scan the root. Those tend to be very tight tolerances. And sometimes they want the contour or the shape of the airfoil itself. Those tend to be a little bit looser. And then you have the edges, the dangerous edges.
So the answer
those are tough.
It depends.
It depends.
It depends. Mm-hmm. All right. Well, you brought some parts with you, so we can actually look at some things here in front of us. So why don't we start here with this, what is that?
It's a nail gun. This is a Bosch nail gun, and basically it's got some interesting features. There's the original die-cast component, and then there's some machining that was done to the process later on. And that, as Brian was saying, it's not really the component, but the processes that we have to look at to decide whether we actually scan or not to scan.
Okay.
Or whether to use a laser scanner.
Okay, mm-hmm. So scan or not scan this? What do you think?
I think a laser scan, the die-cast aluminum, will be a very advantageous. There's a lot of detail on this component, so a laser scanner would collect all of that information very rapidly. When you go into the internal components, you could actually either not scan, you could use touch probing on this component, depending on the tolerances. Now, if the tolerances got down really tight, it may be advantageous to scan them.
Okay. Yep. Okay. And I would say I would add a little bit, this face right here might be a fit issue. So again, if you're looking at an operation that was making that or an issue in assembly, you might actually scan that as well for profile.
Okay. All right. Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, let's look at the next one. What's the next thing here? Looks like some kind of a stamping?
Yeah, this is a safety belt holder.
Okay.
It's a sheet metal component. And so, let's see what everybody see.
Yep.
So what do you think,
a part like this, stamping, I would probably be touch trigger probe. Probably wouldn't be scanning it. You could check the profile, the hole locations, but the tolerances aren't real tight. I don't think form is a big issue, so I wouldn't scan it.
Yeah, I'd have to agree with that. I think that's a good.
I would agree as well. It's a simple part, actually. Maybe a lot of features on it, but scanning doesn't gain you anything on this part.
No. So if someone came to you with that part and said, I want you to scan this, what would you say to them?
And tell them it's...
You're wasting your money spending it on a scanning machine.
Yeah. Totally agree.
Okay. All right. Well, let's move on to the next one. What do we got there?
So we've got here a medical component. It's a knee joint. So this is a really nice component.
It's a femoral.
You're going to most probably scan it because of the profile. The main feature is this complex profile, so you will most probably scan it.
Yeah.
Now, some of these femorals, they don't want to actually touch them, so there's other options in probing that we might propose.
But you'd be scanning with some kind of density. You're interested in that whole shape, right?
Yeah.
And let's be a little specific about it. We would probably not laser scan. Mm-hmm. We would touch scan or analog scan because we want the accuracy on that. Because typically in medical segments or medical sector, they tend to tightly tolerance their parts because of the effect of recalls would be a very bad thing.
There is one other sensor that we could use, the white light sensor, and that might actually give you some very good numbers. It's using chromatic white light, and it's extremely accurate, and it can work well on very shiny surfaces.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. So, and the part on here is there's cross-sectional profiles, so at 10 degrees, 20 degrees, 40 degrees, they'll do cross-sections.
Okay.
And then they'll do linear ones this way.
Okay. Mm-hmm. All right.
So a similar component is this.
And the mating component.
Mating
actually.
Component, that sort of works with it. So this
so
has
if you
got,
scan the one, would you scan the other?
Yes.
Yeah, okay.
And the main thing is that there's a lot of profile call lights on this. Mm. So in the industry, if you look in industry currently, there's definitely a push to go away from straightforward dimensions and control things more with profile.
Okay. Mm-hmm. All right.
And the datums on this part, the bottom face is your primary datum, and a lot of times I want to know the thickness. Well, if you have a form issue on this bottom face, getting the thickness could be a problem unless you're scanning.
Yeah. Okay.
Okay.
All right.
So this is quite an interesting component. It's a die-cast component, a little bit like this other one here. Mm-hmm. It has machine features. It has pretty generally toleranced holes, but then internally it has some fairly high accuracy features and bores in where the control pistons go in here. So it's a top plate of a automatic transmission that goes on there.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
All right.
What do
you think, Brian? So scan or not scan that?
This one definitely does not have one answer because of the different variety of features on the part. So if you were receiving, say, the part from a supplier of yours, you might, as the casting, do a laser scan on the casting surfaces of it. You would, on the flip side of it, completely different part now, you might analog scan the face here because there's likely to be a tight tolerance form call out on there.
And it because has to be a seal.
There has to be a seal between it and the transmission. And then the bores as well, you're going to analog scan those on the inside. But you do have some features that you would consider touch probing on just for speed, and that would be the threaded holes and maybe some of the outer holes on the outside.
Okay. So when you said touch probe and scan, so you're talking about a multi-sensor machine.
You're definitely talking about a multi-sensor machine here. Yep. Yeah. Yep.
What do you think, Dan? You look like you have something to say.
Yeah, multi-sensor machine. So you got the laser, CMS scanner, analog scanner for the face, and then touch trigger probe.
The nice thing about with the Hexagon product line, our scanning probes that would do the analog scanning on the top, we can also touch probe very rapidly, and that gives us the ability to do the mixed analog scanning and touch probing very, very accurately and very fast.
Mm-hmm. So, how about that black plastic one there? What's that?
So this component fits more likely into a vision machine.
Okay.
And vision machines can also scan.
Really? So, how does that work?
So it depends what type of sensors. There's multi-sensors that can go on them. You can use white light sensors, or you can use laser sensors, or you can use camera. And a camera can actually with the image, we can take high-density point gathering on holes and other features.
Mm-hmm.
So this, if you were to choose a vision machine, most probably would scan it.
Okay. All right.
And this is a plastic part, automotive connector. A lot of times, there's a profile call out because you have to have a tight seal so you don't get water inside. So doing that outside profile of the camera is very useful.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
Another thing that just to mention is, so one of the main things that you really need to do is to, when choosing whether to scan or not to scan, is to understand your processes.
Yes.
If you really understand your processes, that will actually decide what you're going to do. With this component here, there's the way that it's manufactured, the material is slightly thicker here than here. So even though it's a seal, it could actually have shrinkage and sinkage, and you need to be looking for that. So that's where scanning can be really, really
be useful.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Well, we're kind of running out of time, so I'm just going to give you each a minute to sort of give a summary. Dan, if company comes to you and says, I want to scan my parts, what do you say?
Oh, I got to look at a drawing, look at the how many form callouts do you have, and what's your budget, and you know, kind of determine whether scanning meets the requirement.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Jonathan, what do you?
I look at a couple of things. I look at the tolerances, and I also look at the depth of bores. Mm-hmm. One of the nice things about the scanning probes are their styli length is extended. Mm-hmm. So, for instance, we do have some of our customers who use 400 millimeter styli that let us reach deep into a component. Mm-hmm. And even though we touch probe some of those components, we use a scanning probe because it gives you that helps accessibility. So I always look at it to make an individual choice on the actual components they manufacture. So we like to provide the professional interpretation.
Okay. And Brian, bring us home.
I would say mainly that Hexagon has the ability with our probes, our scanning probes in particular, to touch probe very quickly. So you really can't go wrong with a Hexagon product being able to do both if you need to. But we still, in reviewing a customer's applications, look at each of the things that both Dan and Jonathan said in order to determine how the customer should approach each part. And in our training, we make sure that they know that.
The belief of our company is to spend no more than they need to, but no less than they need
all right.
to.
Mm-hmm. Very good. And no matter what you're trying to scan or how you're trying to inspect a part, it's important to hold it right.
Yeah.
Isn't
yes.
that right? That's well, right. and we've got something for you there, so take a look at this.
SwiftFix from Hexagon Metrology is a modular part holding system designed specifically with measurement in mind. SwiftFix aids part holding for inspection by many types of measuring equipment, such as portable measuring arms, stationary coordinate measuring machines, laser scanning devices, and optical and multi-sensor systems. The modular concept of the SwiftFix system means that fixtures of varying sizes and complexity can be constructed. And then, once the fixture is no longer needed, the parts can be stripped down and reused for another fixture. SwiftFix is based on a reusable lightweight aluminium plate, into which various types of holding and clamping components can be inserted to build up the required fixture. The multi-tapped base plates are supplied with a connection kit, which allows for multiple plates to be joined together in order to assemble fixtures for the holding of larger components. SwiftFix components are sold separately and in three predefined kits designed to match the complexity of the parts to be measured. The bronze kit includes 46 elements for the assembly of basic fixtures. The silver kit has 66 elements, and the gold kit contains 93, ideal for larger or more complex workpieces. SwiftFix allows for unlimited fixture configurations all from one kit. There's no need for expensive dedicated fixtures. No matter how complex the component to be measured, SwiftFix from Hexagon Metrology is flexible enough to offer the required solution. With just one kit, you have hundreds of fixtures. Just build, measure, strip down, and build again.
With me now is Scott Holland from our Hexagon Metrology North American Services Group. Welcome, Scott.
Thank you.
So, Scott, describe what you do at Hexagon Metrology in the services organization.
Well, I'm the training manager there, so I teach all of these service engineers on how to properly maintain their machines.
So you know a little bit about CMM maintenance then?
I do.
So I asked you to come on the program so you could give our viewers a few tips on how to keep their CMM running well. So what's the importance of preventative maintenance?
Well, preventative maintenance allows the machine to be able to perform at its optimal measurement performance. And it allows us to make sure that the machine is going to run for a long period of time.
Okay. Are there things that a CMM user can do themselves in this regard?
Sure. One of the main things you can do is replace the filters that are on the back of the machine. There's a coalescent and a particle filter that's on the back of the machine, and you want to make sure that those remain clean.
Okay.
Some other things you may want to do is make sure that the machine is clean itself. Dust and dirt can fall from the environment around it, and the bearings need a special gap to be able to float. And when the bearing runs over this dust and dirt, it can actually clog the bearing. So you want to make sure that the ways are clean.
Okay. And how often should you be doing these things?
Well, it depends on the environment that the machine's in. I mean, if your environment is very clean, then you may not have to do it very often. But if your environment is maybe on a shop floor, you may have to do this quite often.
So maybe I'm not so good at doing some of these things. You know,
sure.
Maybe I'm not so good at keeping my machine clean. What's the risk?
Well, the risk is bearing failure. The bearing can get clogged, and when that gets clogged, the gap will lessen. And then eventually it will hit the bearing way. And when it hits the bearing way, then it can actually score the bearing way.
Okay.
And that can then become a very costly repair.
Okay. And those filters, what if I'm not very good at changing my furnace filter either. What if I forget about checking the filters? What's my risk there?
The risk is the same. The air bearings are what you're really trying to protect. They're basically floating on a cushion of air, and if they get clogged in any way, then the air gap gets less. It's very simple. You can just take the unscrew the filter on the back and replace it with a new one.
Okay. And how often should I be doing that?
Again, it depends on your environment that you're in.
What's a good rule of thumb?
I would say I would check your filters once a month,
okay.
And then if you find that they are clean, then you can check them every 2 months, or then every 6 months, and maybe every year after that.
Good, that's good advice. So thanks for those tips. Since you're involved in training, I also understand that you've been working on something that called Hexagon Metrology U, putting together some online coursework that we've introduced. Are we going to be looking forward to a program on CMM maintenance in the HMU?
Absolutely, absolutely. I'm designing a course today and over the period of this conference, and it will be available on Hexagon U very soon.
Excellent. Well, we're looking forward to that. And now we're going to take a look and see what Hexagon Metrology U is all about. Thank you, Scott, for being on the program.
Thank you.
And now let's take a look at Hexagon Metrology U.
Continuing education helps develop skills and increases worker productivity. Hexagon Metrology now offers an innovative game changer in metrology training, Hexagon Metrology U. Our online courses represent thousands of hours of metrology application courseware development, converted into an interactive format and delivered to your desktop 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. Hexagon Metrology U is the primary follow-up platform after students have completed classroom training. Free reference materials related to each Precision Center training class are available to students on Hexagon Metrology U for a full year after each class. Dozens of additional e-learning metrology classes are available for a fee. These classes concentrate on fundamental concepts and supplemental metrology skills. Courses such as Math for Metrology, Blueprint Interpretation, VB Scripting, Alignments 101, and Constructions 101. Hexagon Metrology U's e-learning classes are a great complement to on-site training classes and can also be used for basic skill development or refresher learning. You can also choose from a variety of free fundamental courses on portable arms, CMMs, vision systems, or laser trackers. With Hexagon Metrology U, it has never been easier to invest in career and skills development. Enroll today at hexagonmetrologyu.com and get started with the most innovative training in the industry.
Well, that's all we have time for. I'd like to thank all my guests, and I'd like to thank you for watching. Be sure to check out all of our corporate news and information on our Hexagon All Corporate News portal, hxgnnews.com. And you can also check out more product information and product reviews and product previews on youtube.com/hexagonmetrology. Thanks for watching. Bye-bye.